ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما عباد الله سنتحدث اليوم عن الجهل وعواقبه وانتشاره بين الناس. My brothers and sisters, today we shall speak about ignorance and how it has been spread amongst the people, Muslim and non-Muslim alike, and about its consequences. We were created not knowing anything in this world, just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran. وَاللَّهُ أَخْرَجَكُمْ مِنْ بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا. And Allah has brought you forth from the wombs of your mothers, not possessing any knowledge in anything. This is how we as humans were created. And this is something that will continue unless you take the time to remove that ignorance from yourselves. What is your role as a Muslim? What is your role as somebody who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who dedicates his life to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Let us look at the best of examples. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, khatib al-nabiyyin wa rusul, what did he used to do? Qala alayhi salatu wassalam, or kama qala fi al-Qur'an al-Kareem, qul inna salati wa nusuki wa mahyaya wa mamati lillahi rabbil alameen. لا شريك لك وبذلك أمرت وأنا أول المسلمين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, He says, say to Muhammad, say that your salah and your sacrifice and your life and your death is for Allah, the one, the true God, the Lord of the world, the Lord of the universe. And say that I associate no partners in worship with Him. And with that I was commanded, and I am the first of the Muslims. He is our role. His salah, his sacrifice, his life and his death was for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what we should be doing. Every moment of your life should be to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to show Him that your life and your death and your sacrifice and your salah is for Him alone. But how is that possible when you are living in a society that is pulling you away from Islam? Rather, you are living in a society that will set up groups that will gather in crowds, and they will call and preach against Islam, saying it is a barbaric, saying it is a unjust and oppressive religion. This is what is happening today, as what has happened last week. People will gather in crowd and in groups and say, this is what the Muslims do. This is how they behave. That is not true. But we have allowed ignorance to prevail in Muslims and non-Muslims alike. They are unaware of what Islam preaches because we ourselves are lacking it. And the result of that is you can look in your own home and in your own selves. What prevails? When your children go out and they return and you tell them, usually it's the mother that tells them, she says, my son or my daughter, go and pray. And he points and he says, but daddy does not pray. So why should I pray? And this has been cases, wallahi, this has been cases from families coming and saying, this is what happens in my home. Why does that happen? It is because we have allowed ignorance to be that drive that is leading us. The companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to know the value of it so much. كانوا يذهبون وفودا إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. They used to go in large crowds to the Prophet ﷺ and spend 10, 15, 20 days just learning the religion from him ﷺ. They would leave their families, they would leave their businesses, and they would stay there in the mosque and learn from him days at a time. ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ وَلَمَّا رَأَى النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ شَوْقًا لِأَهَالِينَا قَالَ اِذْهَبُوا وَارْجِعُوا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِكُمْ فَادْعُوهُمْ إِلَىٰ الْإِسْلَامِ. He used to tell them after he seen that they had begun to feel, or they had begun to feel that feeling of missing their family, he said, go back to your people and teach them. After he had noticed that they had begun to feel that way. So, the point is this, we need to try our very best to not allow ignorance to be that driving role, to not allow people who claim that they want to do good for Islam, then they do bad. Or people who claim that Islam is an oppressive religion, yet they are basing their ideas and they are basing their thoughts off of baseless arguments, just like the people in the past have done. During the Prophet's time, do you know what they used to say? To try to say his argument is not valid. What did they used to say to the Messenger of Allah? They used to say, مَا لِهَذَا الرَّسُولِ يَأْكُلُ الطَّعَامِ وَيَمْشِي فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ لَوْ لَا أُزِلَ إِلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ فَيَكُونَ مَعَهُ نَذِيرًا. ما هذا الكلام؟ انه يأكل الطعام؟ انه يمشي في الأسواق؟ They used to say, as I mentioned in the Quran, the people, they did not want to follow the Prophet ﷺ, so they brought baseless arguments against him. They said, what is with this messenger? He eats food, and he walks into the marketplaces just as we do. If only an angel was brought down with him, so that angel will be a warner with him. This was their argument. This is why they did not want to have Allah as their one true God, because the messenger that came used to eat food. This is a baseless argument. And this is what happens today. You will find that some people will have arguments, I want to be a practicing Muslim. Yet, I cannot see why I have to pray 5 times a day. Or he says, or she says, I want to be a practicing Muslim, yet I do not know why I need to dress modestly and wear the hijab. Is this what is preventing you from worshipping Allah alone, from submitting yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That is what is preventing you from doing so? This cannot be. This cannot be the reason why. You need to find a more valid reason. And there is no reason. There is none. You are supposed to just submit yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this is what happens. When you allow others to speak on behalf of Islam, this may be your brethren, your sister, your child, your children. Your children are exposed to this daily. Wallahi, they are exposed to it daily. And they do not know what to believe. If you tell him, come and pray, you tell him, worship Allah, you tell him, learn to read the Quran, do you know what he says? He says, I don't even know why I need to learn how to read this. This happens. Wallahi, they come and they tell them, come read Quran. He says, why do I need to learn this? Do you know why? It's not his fault. Because he is mixing with people that don't believe in that. So it is natural for him to want to follow what his best friend says. Because he spends most of his time over there in school, or he spends most of his time going to an after-school party or after-school activity, or whatever it is. So he is going to carry the traits of those people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the best of guidance. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as it is mentioned in Sahih Muslim, he has said that إِنَّ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى لَا يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ إِنْتِزَاعًا يَنْتَزِعُهُ مِنَ النَّاسِ أو يَنْتَزِعُهُ مِنَ الْعِبَادِ وَلَكِنْ يَنْتَزِعُهُ بِقَبْضِ الْعُلَمَاءِ حتى إذا لم يبقى عالما اتخذ الناس رؤوسا جهالا فسئلوا فأفتوا بغير علم فضلوا وأضلوا. هذا واقعنا اليوم. This is what is prevailing today, brothers and sisters. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, or as He has conveyed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not remove knowledge at one time. Rather, or He does not remove knowledge at one time from the slaves. Rather, what He does is that He removes knowledge by having the scholars pass away in Islam. The scholars are removed, they pass away. So He says, as there is nobody left, the people will take on the ignorant as their leaders. The people will take on the ignorant as their leaders. And they will be asked questions. Those ignorant people will be asked questions. They have no idea what the answer is, but they will give an answer. And they will be misguided, and they will misguide. Now don't look at just the Sheikh is the one that is misguided. Look at it in a larger picture, look at it in a smaller scenario. That goes to as far as even the head of the household in the home. Who is the leader at home? The father. The father needs to be that driving force behind. You have a big responsibility. And you can gain lots of reward should you fulfill that gap that is necessary. You have an important job. Live up to that job. Ask Allah to help you, and Allah will help you in that. And the mother as well. And so on and so forth. You teach your children these things. They are in need of it, wallah. You don't know what comes to them outside. This is a new world that we have not experienced, or our children have not seen before. So there are many things to pull them away from that. My brothers and sisters, there are two extremes in this. In arrogance or ignorance. There is one extreme that will try to say, these are Islamic values, and they could not be farther from the truth. Just like you see in different parts of the world, now you have people walking into a marketplace, walking into a mall, and murdering innocents. Murdering hundreds of innocents, and then locking it down and saying, this is the name of it. We're doing this in the name of Islam. A'udhu billah. A'udhu billah that Islam should be attributed to something as evil as this. Just like when the people of Bani Israel used to say to Musa, in the Quran al-Kareem, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تَذْبَحُوا بَقَرًا. ماذا قال؟ قالوا أتتخذنا هزوا؟ قال موسى قال أعوذ بالله أن أكون من الجاهلين. Prophet Moses عليه السلام, as it is mentioned in the Quran, he said to his people, Bani Israel, he told them, Allah has commanded you to slaughter a cow. He said, are you making fun of us? Are you making fun of us? Allah wants us to do something like this. This is something so trivial, something so simple. He wants us to do this? They didn't want to do it. What was his reply? He said, A'udhu billah, I seek refuge in Allah that I should become like the ignorant. Ignorance is something that is very, very misguided, and it is something that is so prevalent amongst the people that we tend to overlook it because we are trying to focus on other things. So you have people that attribute themselves to Islam that say, this is what we need to do. And they do something that is far from Islam. Partly because they are misguided, partly because they are ignorant, partly because they are following their own desire. And on the other end of the spectrum, you have someone who will say we need to be more like the Christians or the people of the book or the Jews. And we need to imitate them. We need to hold activities and concerts like them. No. You need to call them to Islam. Yes. You need to show them what Islamic values is or what Islamic values are. You need to teach them that you need to submit yourself to the one true God. And you need to follow the people of knowledge in doing so, because if you do not, you will fall under misguidance. Every field has its specialists. Every single field has its specialists. And Islam especially has its specialists. It has the scholars. If some person was to come forward and say, I have come up with a medical procedure, it is amazing. Let me tell you about it. He says that all you need to do is lay this person out. I'm going to take my utensils and I'm going to work on this person right now. He has no background of being a surgeon or being a doctor of any kind. But he is going to speak on that field. Does that make sense? The doctors and the surgeons will say to this man, somebody needs to take him and put him in a mental asylum. Need to put him away. This is the same thing in regards to Islam. If somebody comes to speak on behalf of Islam, non-Muslim, Muslim, and he has no knowledge on Islam, he needs to keep quiet on that matter. Because you will just be spreading misguidance and lies. And this is what happens when we speak quiet. Those people emerge. Those with evil intentions, those with misguidance emerge. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه غفور رحيم. If what I have said so far is not convincing, there is just ayah after ayah, verse after verse, hadith after hadith that will tell you that when it comes to speaking on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you need to be very cautious. You need to be very cautious and you need to make sure that it is what Allah has intended and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for us to follow. In a hadith narrated in Bukhari and Muslim, قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن العبد لا يتكلم بالكلمة ما يتبين فيها يزل بها في النار أبعد يزل بها في النار أبعد مما بين المشرق. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says that the slave shall say a word or a phrase and that he is not certain of what its meaning is, except that it will throw him in hellfire, the distance that is between the east, or the distance of the east. Let me repeat that again. He says that the slave shall say a word, or one phrase, because of its importance, because of its greatness. He says he will say one word, he will not be certain of what it means, except that it will push him, or it will throw him into hellfire, the distance of the east. Look at who was he referring to? He said, "Inna al-'abd." He was referring to al-'abd, to the slave. He was not talking about a non-Muslim. But even then, he is still held accountable for that. And knowing that, a Muslim has good intentions for Islam. He doesn't wish to speak lies. You need to make sure of what you're saying. And the only way to do that is to refer to the specialist, to refer to the people of knowledge. But it will throw him. He will not make sure of it, and it will be something that will misguide himself, something that will misguide others, and it will throw him into hellfire to the distance of the east. Oh my, that is not a simple matter. You may have good intentions. You may have some good that you want to come out of this, but if it is not correct, then you should refrain from doing so, or if you're not sure, then you should refrain from doing so. The companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كانوا إذا قرأوا عشر آيات لم يخلفوها إلا بعد أن ماذا؟ بعد أن يتعلموا معانيها وأن يعملوا بما فيها من الأحكام. When the companions used to learn the Quran, he said that we would memorize the Quran, and we would learn of its meaning, and we would act upon it. We would learn 10 ayahs at a time. They would not go to the next 10 unless they acted upon those verses, and they memorized them, and they knew them. And then he says, فَجَمَعْنَا بَيْنَ الْعِلْمِ وَالْعَمَلِ. He says, and we combine between knowledge and doing action. And that is all you are asked from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To learn about the religion and to act upon it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us all in knowledge. May He increase us all in knowledge and forgive us for our shortcomings that we have been doing for the past years. My brothers and sisters, Wallahi, I would like to suggest something. It is a good idea. It is a good idea to at least meet once a month in the mosque. Everyone can come and bring his family and share some food. And we will have a small talk, something about the life of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, to learn how he lived. And we can come here and we can share the company of one another. We can have our children make friends with one another, because when they are outside, they make friends with people that pull them away from Islam. If you tell him, could you come to the mosque? He says, I don't want to come to the mosque. I don't know anyone there. But I want to go to my friend's house, so and so. And his friend doesn't want to teach Islam. His friend doesn't want to teach him about loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is something that, wallahi, if you guys are interested, let us gather and pick a day and say we are going to meet this day. And we are going to gather and we are going to learn about the book of Allah and about the guidance of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم ارزقنا علما نافعا ورزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا اللهم لا تجعل لنا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا حاجة إلا يسرتها يا رب العالمين اللهم اهدنا إلى أحسن الأخلاق لا يهدي لأحسنها إلا أنت واصرف عنا سيئها لا يصرف عنا سيئها إلا أنت عباد الله الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين وأقم الصلاة